Thanks very much for joining us. Welcome everyone watching this, the first PCA vodcast series, joined by England legends, former England legends, Graham Swann, Tim Bresnan and Paul Collingwood. We're going to focus on the 2010-11 Ashes success down under. But before we do that, lads, you're all looking well. How is lockdown and the coronavirus pandemic treating you, Swanee?
I'm loving every minute. It turns out I've been sacked from my homeschooling job already, being grossly incompetent. I phoned up my own parents to apologise for thinking I knew best when I was a kid. And I'm having some comeuppance for the way I carried on as a human being and a cricket player. So, but the cat's happy.
They love Dr. Doolittle. Brez, you got the hair battened down under the cap. Are you well?
I'm good, mate. Thank you. Yeah, good. Just a quick one. Was that one that you rescued from under the floorboards?
No, this is the sister. This is Max. That was Paddy.
Right.
He might come in a bit. Hopefully, my dog Bobby Robson will make an appearance as well. He's cool.
He slightly squashed that one. The other one. Collie, how are you, mate?
Yeah, all good. It's quite nice to have a few weeks off, to be honest with you. I think with all the coaching and going around the world, and South Africa was busy last year, was obviously busy with the World Cup and Ashes. It's actually quite nice just to have a bit of relaxation time, but back into it next week, one-on-one. So back into work.
Who have you been designated? Have you got Woody or something?
No one as yet. I think the bowlers are going in first, so I'm kind of kept out of the way of the bowlers.
Very underrated, your bowling, Collie.
Wicket to wicket, mate, 72 mile an hour. It's gone out of the game, hasn't it?
Mike Hussey in Sydney, that's all I'll say.
Well, we're gonna get on to Mike Hussey in Sydney, so let's focus on this 2010-11 tour. I know you're not long off the watch-along from the World T20 success, but Collie, I'll start with you, because you toured Australia 4 years earlier and was part of that squad that got properly thumped. And I know you guys, you know, that happened to you 4 years after, but this was the tour in between when everything seemed to go right. Did you get a sense from the outset when you were leaving that this was going to be a very different experience in the Ashes in Australia?
Whenever you go to Australia, I think there's always that kind of that anxious feel in your body, because you're never quite sure how it's going to go. Even if you've got a really good team, you know that you're coming up against, you know, Australia in their home, in their backyard. I think there's always going to be what's going to happen for the next few months. And I was actually involved with the 2002-3 series as well, which we got absolutely thumped. And it's not a very nice place to be when you're getting. When you're getting hammered, obviously 2007, we got hammered 5-0. So it's not the best. And so you're always a bit worried that it's going to go down that route again. But this one was, from start to finish, I think was probably the perfect tour in terms of how it went, our preparation, even the warm-up games. We went into those with a real ambition to win the games rather than just trying to get into form and stuff. So it was certainly, in my eyes, probably the most memorable tour I've been on, and satisfying tour I've been on, because of, you know, how difficult it is to win in Australia.
It's funny, because we had Brez was a good luck charm at that stage. I think he played 5, won 5, and it was going to be played 13, won 13. Did you sense there was a really good spirit in the camp, and there was a good blend of kind of youth and old?
Yeah, I think we knew going there. I mean, we'd won in 2009. As Collie said, Andy Flower was very keen to use the warm-up games as a mini Ashes. So rather than, you know, play 15 aside and not really give a monkeys about who wins the game, we actually went in and played really hard cricket. And we won in Perth. We went to Adelaide. Actually, Adelaide is where the sprinkler dance came from, because on the last day of the warm-up game, we were ready for the Ashes. We played some brilliant cricket. We played some hard-nosed cricket. But we were due to field all the last day, the fourth day of this game in Adelaide. And the weather forecast was a bit iffy. So a couple of lads had a glass of wine with their meals and decided it was going to rain. And Collie ended up in a nightclub at some point doing a sprinkler dance. And the next day we turned up thinking it'd be wet, cracking flags. I've never seen 11 more miserable human beings because we had to field. And after about two balls that Brodie bowled, this black cloud arrived out of nowhere, absolutely banged it down. We sprinted off the field. I've never seen 11 happier human beings. And we were in the changing room all dancing around and Collie said, oh, what about that sprinkler I saw last night? Oh, that was mint. And that became the unofficial dance of the trip from that point on.
I tell you what, Swanee, I'm amazed you've given us credit because all these years you've actually taken the credit yourself for starting that sprinkler dance.
Collie, I name check you all the time. I mean, I've taken the royalties for it, but I name check you all the time.
Swanee, the last time I saw you, you were dancing World in Motion with John Barnes, so it doesn't get much better than that. Brez, you didn't play obviously first few test matches. They just saved up the lucky charm for when they really needed those wins towards the back end in Melbourne and Sydney. I think Melbourne was your sixth test. You've been around the group for a while, but what's it like being on the fringes of things in at the Gabba and Adelaide while the guys are out there doing battle? How tough is that as a tourist?
It's good to be there and witness. I mean, the two previous games were two unbelievable games of cricket, like, and Perth as well. So the three before that, before Melbourne, were just phenomenal games. I mean, Cookie and Trotty in Brisbane, Siddle's hat-trick, Jimmy and, well, Straussy fighting with Ricky Ponting in Adelaide. Like, everything was just going on. But to sort of have the front row seat on the side of the pitch running drinks on and stuff, it was obviously good to be there. And obviously when I played in Melbourne, I think it was Finney that missed out, but he was the leading wicket taker at that time and he was fully fit. But I think the call was because he was just going for a few too many runs, I think. Which was bizarre from my point of view. Obviously I took it, Ash's debut Boxing Day MCG, unbelievable start to my Ash's career, just watching the guys and the close-knitness that everyone had, and like Swanee said, we took the warm-up games on like a mini series, and you know, the bowlers went up to Brisbane early, and we were left down in Hobart. Yeah. But we had some unbelievable trips. Like, Collie organised us to play golf in Hobart, didn't you?
Collie's Tours. Collie's Tours. Went up to Bombugal, didn't we? We took a little, a six-seater or something. We took.
Was it? I actually flew it, didn't I? For a little bit.
Anyone on a plane, if you're going to turn and give the controls to anyone, if someone says, Brez, it's your man, I would jump straight out the window, I promise you.
Because I was going, lads, we're going left. Like, they were all going, no, forget off them controls, Brez, what are you doing? Because it was like six seats and the seven of us went, so I was in like the co-pilot seat, just like, literally, that's one who was going to bubble wrap me to the chair.
You know, you mentioned Melbourne there, your Ashes debut, Brez. That's still my favourite day's cricket of my entire life. First day at the MCG with 97,000 people, 25,000 of them at Barmy Army. Love you guys. So you've got 72,000 Aussies and they're all in fancy dress and it's the biggest day of the sporting calendar in Australia. And we bowled them out for 98. I bowled two overs. I took an unbelievable catch to get Ponting out, but that was all I did. And then watched Straussy and Cookie get 160 for none. And by the end of play, all the Barmy Army was still there. And there were 72,000 Aussies who'd gone home. David Lloyd on TV said, oh, look, it's fancy dress day here. 72,000 Aussies have come as empty seats.
I absolutely hate that David Lloyd impression. Because I say this to Swanee all the time. It reminds me of the time when I think I reeled off a couple of 30s and 100 and was playing quite well. And he phoned me up. He was with Keezy. And he phoned me up when Bumble was coach of England and pretended I was very close to selection. I genuinely thought it was David Lloyd phoning me up.
Yeah, I still feel bad about that, Paul.
Yeah, thanks.
Why, you did that?
He did, he absolutely stuffed me. Keezy's idea, he did a David Lloyd impression. I'm like, oh, very much, Bumble. Yeah, thanks. I keep getting my head down. You never know. I'm ready if you need me kind of thing with Keezy and Swanee wetting the
other end. I wonder why Duncan Fletcher didn't like me. And then I'm reminded of stories like that, and I kind of understand it now.
Let's just go back. No, fine, mate. It's water under the...
Can you do
it? Sorry. No, I'm not. I tend to get nowhere near posh enough. My little boy can. He goes to posh school. No. Oh, actually, Ed, if you're watching, I'm still on the same number. You tweeted me saying, do you want to chat? And that was about 6 months ago. I'm waiting.
Right, I'll pass that on as well if I bump into him. Colleague, let's go back to the first test, because obviously we were behind the game for quite a while. Got bowled out in that first innings for 260. The Aussies made 481. And then the small matter of 517 for one ensued. I mean, I can't even recall, but India in their pomp with Dravid and Sachin or whatever racking up 500 plus for one. I mean, obviously you didn't bat in that second innings, but just watching, what did that do for the team just to see the Aussies in the dirt for that long and Trotty and Cookie and Straussie play so well?
Yeah, well, the momentum completely shifted. So it was almost kind of, here we go again after the first innings. We got a low total. And then they got, as you said, 400 odd, and you think this could well be a long tour. It's because it's amazing how early those, when you grab those opportunities as a team early on and you get ahead of the other team, it can completely suffocate you for the rest of the tour. And so I think that as an innings and as a benchmark, I think that was the real kind of turning point, because it proved that we could definitely score big runs against their bowling attack. But it gave us a real steeliness as well. To come out of that game with a draw and almost try to put them under pressure a little bit with the ball at the end there, it was a huge turning point. And not at one point when I was watching did you think they're going to get out. They're just not going to get out. I mean, usually when you're waiting to go in a bat, there's nerves around and they're just absolutely like bowling against a brick wall. It was incredible batting. And I think the Australian press actually got on top of the Aussies quite early on because of that. So
I always say the Aussie press on that trip, they were like the crowd in Rocky IV at the start who were cheering for the Russian, Drago, Drago. And then as soon as we got on top, they were screaming abuse at the Australians, England, England.
We'll gloss over that. The Brez, I know you were playing in that first match, but... bowlers like nothing better than a top order that properly drops anchor. What does that do for a bowler when you see your top three play like that?
I think that's one of the only things I can remember from that test match, actually, is seeing Swanee, Jimmy, Brody and Tremors pretty much sleep the whole time. Like,
you slept,
you didn't move a muscle because they didn't. Because like, Swanee's so superstitious that he won't let anyone. So whoever bags the physio bed, if you needed treatment, you were stuffed because you weren't allowed to move if you got on there for a kip, because Swanee won't let you. But yeah, like, you lads slept for pretty much 2.5 days, didn't you?
We did. We lay on the floor. We had rolled up towels as pillows, and it went me, Brody, then Jimmy. We started off like that, and it went well. So we stayed like that for a while. And then we were just laughing and joking, almost euphoric. But I tell you what it did do. It showed that putting overs in people's legs. I mean, we kept the Aussies out there for 2.5 days. I say we, the top three did. But they were a very average bowling attack by the end of it. You know, when they were fresh on day one, they looked really good. But the longer you keep anyone out there, they become blunt. And they were so blunt by the end, they could barely stand up. I remember Siddle, after his hat-trick heroics in the first innings, walked off at the end of the game, looking like he was about 75 years old.
Yeah.
This is Bobby Robson, by the way. Bobby,
hello, hello. Bobby. Black and white Bobby. So I would have thought, let's talk Kev, because we'll move on to Adelaide. I mean, he must have had massive pad rash watching that 517 for one. So to come out and to smash a double hundred at Adelaide, Collie, I mean, you've been there on the previous tour getting your double hundred in Adelaide with Kev. It's obviously a ground that he enjoyed, but that must have been a very special effort, and the pace at which he scored enabled you to force that victory after bowling them out cheaply.
Yeah, I mean, Kev was, probably from the players that I've seen, probably the best player batsman I've seen play for England. So you knew he had it in him. And it was just pure Kev. It was just pure relaxation out in the middle. And almost he was dominating that much that you almost felt as though you were playing at home. And the Aussie bowlers just did not have an answer to it. He was standing, he was doing different stances. He went for the short ball. He was standing like baseball. He was still whacking it. He was almost taking the mickey at times. That's how it kind of changed the old battle that they had in the first test there on top. And then obviously we got a draw, but we felt as though we'd almost won that first test. And then you go into Adelaide and then you get that kind of performance from KP, double 100, then the Aussies are massively under the pump then.
Was there a sense it was very different from 4 years earlier? Because obviously you and him had that amazing partnership, but you still managed to lose that test match and they came back at you. Was there a sense in this particular game that you were really, you had your foot on the throat? Was it a very different feeling?
Yeah, it was. I think things just went for us. Like Trotty's run out and then, you know, a couple of early wickets. I think Swanee caught a catch low down straight away. And it was almost once we got the momentum, there was no stopping us. And we weren't doing anything with the ball. We weren't doing anything spectacular. It was just real good, solid, hard line and length ball. And the Aussies wanted to almost drive you off the length. They wanted to try to get on top of us. And we were just so disciplined in what we did. And the fielding alongside it was fantastic. We were taking all the chances. We were getting the runouts, all that kind of stuff. And it was almost like, right, we've got them. This early on, it feels as though we've got them.
Well, I remember when we lost the toss because we'd seen the wicket was an absolute feather bed and Adelaide is hot. And you're just thinking, please win the toss. We've got to bat. And we lost the toss and we're bowling. And I remember in the change room, even though everyone's going, it doesn't matter, it doesn't matter. Everyone really thinking, oh, Jesus. And then Trotty, with the direct hit in the first over to Rankatic out, Ponting nicked it to me off Jimmy first ball. And then Clark did it two overs later. We had the big three really out in the first hour. They were four down at lunch. It was like, I couldn't believe we bowled him out on the first day at Adelaide. And then, like you say, Kev. When Kev batted properly and he attacked people and dominated, the worst bloke you could ever bowl at, because as a bowler, you want someone to, you know, be patient, wait for a bad ball, not try and dominate you, knock you off the line. And Kev, with that sort of, the arrogance that he had and the front he put on as a batsman, their bowlers wilted. And from that moment on, there was no doubt we were winning the game. It was just an absolutely bizarre game. I mean, if a game starts off with Jonathan Trott running someone out of the direct hit, it is a bizarre game of cricket.
Just quickly on Kevin and that innings, Swanee. Obviously, what happened 4 years later, well documented. But at this time in his career and the dynamic of the England team, was this Kev and you guys kind of at your best? Was that always the case at that time? Or was it because you got on a roll against the Aussies and you were kind of crushing them?
Well, you never know because, you know, hindsight's great. But it certainly was. There wasn't an issue at all off the field or on the field. I think maybe to do with Strousey being captain. I think Kev held a lot more respect for Strousey as captain than he did for Cookie later on. So it's hard to say. But, I mean, me and Kev never got on. But I always wanted him in the team because he was a ridiculous batsman. Like Colly said, possibly... he's not the most talented technically that I've seen by a long way because Ian Bell is that. But if you could put Kev's front and sort of machoism and arrogance into Ian Bell, you'd have the greatest players ever played, including Bradman. But Kev just, you know, when he dominated a bowler, that was the worst type of batsman a bowler could ever bowl at. And they had that young spinner, that Doherty, being absolutely pulverised by him. And I feel sorry for that lad because he wasn't the worst bowler in the world. But he was never coming back after that.
Was he the left arm? Was he left arm spinner, Doherty? Was this when they thought that Kev had a problem against all left armers? So they found one, put him in there.
They started with him, and then they ended up playing a guy called Michael Beer in the last test match because he got four wickets against us in a warm-up game. He got four for 120 in the second innings, all caught on the fence. So, you know, I was always very lucky that I played against Australia after Shane Warne had finished, because I think when you're batting last in a game, you've got the greatest bowler ever to play the game, and there's no argument about that in my view. It's a bit trickier than when he's not there. So, I mean, Collie will tell you that he's faced Warne. I mean, he murdered him in Adelaide that time, but pretty decent bowler, wasn't he, Collie?
Yeah, Warne was a different level, but they just didn't have that. I don't know, in that trip, I honestly think we had an amazing team spirit. I just remember us, we were winning those warm-up games and we were partying hard afterwards. Flower said, I really want you to go into every game, the warm-up games, as if you would the were test matches. And we said, that's okay. If you want us to do that, then we need our days off as well. We need our, you know, we need our downtime. We need to have a few beers together. And he actually agreed to it. He said, okay, but, you know, we're going to be really focused from day one. And I think that trip was one of the actual most enjoyable trips, with the golf, with the everything that went on the kind of the times where you weren't training or playing. It was actually a bloody good and enjoyable trip. But it always helps when you're winning, of course. I mean, it's always easy to have a smile on your face. But Christ, I think that was an amazing trip. All 3 months when you're beating Australia, it's just the best place to be. There's those times where you're being absolutely hammered 5-0 and every single person comes and tells you about it. Even when you're in restaurants and stuff. When you're winning out there, it's just superb. It's just like, right, this is payback time.
Of course, the next test was Perth and they did bounce back. I mean, Perth is a tough place to go and they've got a great record there, much as they got a great record at the Gabba. But Brez, I want to pick up on something that Collie said there about the spirit and Andy Flower as well, because obviously you're on that trip a few years later. Was Andy more mellow in 10-11? Did he change over time? Was this when he was at his best as a coach, or was it just the environment was so good?
It's difficult to say whether he was more intense or more mellow. I think he was, I don't know, he was quite mellow in 10-11, but I think he just knew that we were switched on all the time. And I think he knew that we were playing for each other and we'd look after each other, you know, especially after play or in between games and stuff like that. He knew that we were looking after each other. Obviously, we'd been to Germany as well before, which probably one of Swanee's highlights, wasn't it?
that's good. You know what I think about Andy? I think Andy's really hard done by, because he's got this reputation now of being miserable, dour, mood hoover, whatever. The Ryder Cup happened a couple of years after, and Paul McGinley, do you remember? Because he had blue and yellow fish in the team room. Like, his attention to detail was second to none, which is exactly what Andy did before that trip. Just no stone unturned, and we won, and he was lauded and applauded, and everyone said, brilliant coaching. And Tom Watson was the American coach and got slated because he took a laid-back approach. Had the Americans won that Ryder Cup, had the players played better golf, Tom Watson would have been lauded as a genius and McGinley as a stickler for detail and forgetting about the game of golf. So you're always judged on the results. And I just think the atmosphere in the air in 2010, whether it was a more senior team, there weren't players within the side trying to power struggle or whatever you like. It was just a settled dressing room and a successful dressing room. And we were playing an Australian team who were, you know, the opposite.
Perth levelled it up, one apiece. So what do you do when you need to win another match or win a couple of games? You bring a bloke in who only knows how to win. Brez, how different was playing Ashes cricket? And obviously you said your Ashes debut was Melbourne. How different was that to your other England experiences up to that point?
It's difficult to say, because every time I put the shirt on and walked out and sung the anthem, like, I got a massive buzz out of it. Like, so there's no time more than that time, especially when you've got, you know, there was 40,000 Barmy Army singing that's the loudest I've ever heard the national anthem sung as well on Boxing Day. It was 97, as Swanee said earlier, there's 97,000 people in the ground. So, yeah, I was bang up for it. Like, I was just like, this is brilliant. Goosebumps all over pretty much for 2 hours before I even got a chance to bowl. And then, yeah, I was a little nervous, but then first one went down all right. Second one, I think Phil Hughes left. And then third one, I think he smashed straight to Kev at Gully. So that was a great start.
You know what? I remember that president got Ricky Ponton at LBW, shouldering arms. He's given out and he referred it because they were desperate.
That was Watson.
Big
that was Watson.
No, it was Ricky Ponton. It was Ricky Ponton like this.
Wasn't.
Up the big spirit. Oh, no. He sent him outside. Bye. And Jimmy just turned around and said, oh my God, Yorkshire, how thick are Yorkshire? Oh my God. And was just laughing our heads off in the middle.
That was second innings. That was second innings and it was Shane Watson.
We have to give him for thinking it was Shane Watson because he was king of the review, of course.
He was when I was bowling.
Good ball, lad.
Cheers, lad. He had a bullseye on his front pad, didn't he? That's Shane.
Not board pad.
I've got the ball actually, Fultz.
Is that it? That's the ball from Melbourne?
From Melbourne, yeah, second innings.
Is that right? That didn't get flogged off in your benefit year?
No.
Or three others got sold in your benefit year?
No, this is the one. The kids like playing with it too much, to be fair.
Tell you what, that looks like it's going to reverse,
huh?
Hey, did you not remember that? Did you not remember this ball, Collie? It went round corners, didn't it?
Collie, you kind of know where I'm going with this. I mean, you obviously retired after Sydney. You probably didn't get the runs you would have liked to have got in that.
No, I was actually going through a lot of...
But an amazing trip all the same.
Yeah. It was an amazing trip because of the results. I mean, and the team camaraderie... Everything that goes on when you're in Australia, it was results-wise, it couldn't have gone any better, really. Personally, I was going through a bit of a turmoil, really, in terms of form, lost confidence, couldn't score a run. And, you know, when you're going through that and everyone else is doing well, you kind of think, is this my last tour? And it was kind of a crossroads for me, that tour. I said to Andy in Melbourne, and remember we were having a great game there, but I was that low, I said to him, I either try to revamp my technique and try to do that over the next year or something and try to prolong my test career, or I move aside now and allow the next generation to come through. I said, because I can't just keep going on with these dips in form. I mean, it's actually emotionally, it's up and down all the time. It's hard work. So I knew it was a crossroads. And Andy's response wasn't the most positive kind. It wasn't like, yeah, I think we should try for a year and get the technique into a position where you're going to be a lot more consistent. It was kind of, you could just tell. And that was the moment when I was in Melbourne. I just thought, yeah, I think Sydney's going to be my last game. And you almost feel as though you're going to be pushed aside because of your form anyway. But it was a tough tour personally, but one that I still really enjoyed. And you know, no better place than Sydney to be your last Test match and win a series 3-1 against Australia.
And testament to you as well that, despite not scoring many runs, you know, you played all five Test matches. You were picked for all five. You were kind of integral to that team with your experience, and as you'd been throughout your career in the field with the ball. You know, Swanee mentioned at the start picking up Mike Hussey with the ball at a key time was kind of very Paul Collingwood. You might not have got the runs, but you still found a way of impacting the game.
Yeah, I did, but your job in the side is scoring runs, as simple as that. You're the batsman. I took a couple of catches, but that's, again, that's your job in the side. I was surprised that I did get a couple of wickets at Sydney, but you know, you do feel as though you're letting the team down when you're not scoring runs. And, you know, I was putting a brave face on, if I'm entirely honest. When you're not playing as well as you can, you've got good players behind you. Owen Morgan was underneath me at the time, who I thought was going to go on and have a huge test career. You almost feel as though you're standing in the way of good players coming through. And it was a really, kind of selfishly, it was a real low point in my career, but also a real high point at the same time, of obviously winning as a team. So when it's coming to the end of your test career, you know, as a youngster, that's all you ever wanted to do was play test cricket. And so it was kind of, it was a brave face on most of the time, but, you know, I can always have that happy smile on my face, knowing that we'd beat the Australia in Australia.
I'll tell you what I remember on that very last day of Ollie's entire career, Strousey, I mean, the measure of the blow, Strousey is an absolute hero anyway, and he's Collie's best mate within the team because they play the most boring round of golf together all the time, like hitting it straight and lining up putts. But I remember on the last morning, we were obviously going to win. We needed like 2 wickets to win. And we went out and all the Barmy Army turned up and no Australians in the ground. And rather than field at third slip, Strousey just going, "Oh, Collie, old boy, just pop down to third man, would you?" And stand in front of the Barmy Army. We didn't even normally have a third man, but he sent Collie down there so they could just... You'd already announced your retirement, hadn't you? And they knew it, so they just serenaded Collie for about an hour, and it was it still brings a tear to my eye when I think of it. And Collie just dancing in front of the crowd and lapping it up. That must have been a brilliant way to finish off.
No, it was perfect, honestly. I mean, the Barmy Army, the English support that we've had over the years has been incredible. That one test match of, you know, when Mitchell Johnson came in and the whole stand. It was almost like a football atmosphere. And you know, I think, you know, playing professional sport is very much about creating memories. And that to me was one huge memory in my career, was seeing that the whole stand just completely try to take the mickey out of the Australian players. And the atmosphere was incredible. So to bow out at Sydney in front of those amazing fans was certainly special. It was emotional. Christ, I was gone emotionally, but it was, you know, I've still got the cap in the drawer. I've still, you know, I was just amazing. Still got the champagne on it when we're in the dressing room. We had some good celebrations in the dressing room afterwards.
It's a fantastic.
Thoughts.
Go on.
One I remember from that is Trotty coming downstairs in the ice bath. Like, I know it's in the Edge film, but it didn't quite capture the actual moment of it. So pretty much everyone, the first time he did it, everyone in the changing room was like, "Jesus, what was that?" And then you just see Trotty there with his arms there. So he's just come down the stairs in the ice bath. He was like, "What an idiot." Brilliant.
Brilliant. I mean, whilst you might have scored the runs, it sounds like an unbelievable way to go out. I mean, all three of you played your last test match in Australia in very different circumstances for you guys 4 years later, and it was a very different tour. But Swanee, you were knackered and Brezza didn't quite work out for you. So to go out in those, even though Collie didn't score the runs he would have liked, to go out on a winning note is I guess as a player what you hope to do. Not everyone can do an Alistair Cook and
tell you what, I actually blame Collie for the end of my test career being so shambolic, because I wanted the same send off that Collie got in Sydney. And then seriously, I knew I was cooked after the oval, and I thought it'll be all right in the night, they're crap, we'll beat them anyway, Jimmy will do all the bowling, I'll just get 3 throughout the series, but I'll finish at Sydney, I'll have that send off that Collie had. I genuinely thought that was the way forward. It was only when I got out there and I couldn't feel my hand bowling double bounces in the nets. I couldn't even get Broadie out in the nets. I thought, I'm screwed here. Cheers, Cole. Good lad.
And on that note, lads, we're going to leave it. Time is up. Thanks so much for joining in on this first PCA vodcast. Really enjoyed it. Take care. Get the wine in. What a good way to leave it. Cheers, lads.
Cheers, stay safe. Guys, thanks.
See you, Brett. See you, Collie, man.
See you, man.
Cheers, boys.
Cheers, boys.